I'm going to show you why the Menger Sponge is my all-time favorite fractal, and I'm going to show you how to squeeze some pie out of it. But first, we need to start with what is a fractal, and to do that, initially, we need a square. Right, so here I am in a fairly standard issue square. You can see it's got a nice tidy amount of surface area in front, and it's got a finite perimeter going around the edge. We're now going to turn it into a fractal. To do that, we initially just divide the surface up into 9 smaller squares. I'm going to say we're dividing it up into thirds because that's what we're doing in both directions. We can now take the center third and just pop it out. So here we have most of the square still intact. The surface area has gone down slightly. It's now 8/9 of what it was before. And correspondingly, the perimeter has gone up slightly because of this new bit in the middle. But we can repeat the process. Check out these 8 squares. We can divide all of them into thirds. We can pop out the middle bits. And we've now reduced the area again. It's now 8/9 of 8/9 of the original area, and the perimeter's gone up slightly. But why stop there? We can get all of those remaining tiny little squares. We can divide them all up into thirds, pop out the center 9ths from every single one of them, and then repeat. You can do this over and over again. In fact, to be a true fractal, you have to do this infinitely many times. We need to be able to zoom in constantly and never hit the bottom. No matter how far you go down, you will always see the missing bits in the middle. That means if we try and work out the total area of this fractal shape, it's 0, because that's the limit. If you've got 8/9 times 8/9 times 8/9, 8/9 to some power, as that power goes towards infinity, the area goes to 0, whereas the perimeter, because it gets bigger each time, it goes towards infinity. So this is a shape with 0 surface area, but yet an infinite perimeter. This is a 2D shape called a Sapinski carpet, and fractals are now a century old. It was 1916 when Mr. Sapinski first came up with this, and fractals have been amazing people ever since. Although, to be honest, we probably should stop zooming in for a while because this is starting to make me feel a little bit scale sick. Of course, now we can do this one dimension higher to get a true 3D fractal. This time you start with a cube. You could imagine dividing each face up into 9ths and then you punch out the center ones. And effectively what you've done is, if you started with a cube made up of 27 smaller cubes, you've taken out all the ones that cross through the center, leaving this shell of 20 cubes. But you could take each of those 20 cubes and you could repeat the process, punch out the center of all of them, and then you could do that again. And in theory, you could carry this on infinitely many times and you would get the fractal which has 0 volume but yet infinite surface area, the Menger Sponge. You can even make your own one of these. There is an origami method to take 6 business cards. You can fold them all together to make a cube, and then you can actually attach kind of cladding, printed cards onto the outside. And if each of those outside cards has a Sapinski carpet printed onto it, the resulting cube looks like a Menger Sponge. But why stop there? Before you put the cladding on, you could have joined 20 of those cubes together, because they've got little tabs that interlock and they all join quite nicely. Those 20 cubes would give you a level 1 Menger Sponge. Why stop there? 20 cubes, please. What if you made 20 of those level 1s? That would require 400 cubes, but if you were able to get them together, you could make yourself a level 2 Menger Sponge. And of course, for completeness, you could take 20 level 2 Menger Sponges and join them all together to make a level 3. But what a ridiculous origami object that would be. 8,000 cubes, all clipped together, strategically covered in cladding. No one would be ridiculous enough to try such a... Okay, I may have done it. I got together with some friends of mine at the Manchester Science Festival in 2014, and we built a level 3 Menger Sponge. You can see the level 1 sat inside it there, and the whole thing is level 3. What an achievement. And we weren't even the first to make one of these. Origami expert Janine Mosley had previously made a level 3 origami Menger sponge. In fact, she's the one who came up with the technique to do this, but we were so pleased we'd managed to achieve it. And then we thought, well, hang on, why don't we make a level 4? We would just have to make 20 of these, which I will admit, even for me and my ridiculous group of volunteering friends, that is not achievable. To make a level 4 Menger sponge, we worked out you would need around 1 million business cards and you would need people all around the world. You'd pretty much have to build 20 of them in different locations around the planet, which we may have done. So as well as Manchester in the UK, we had other cubes in London and Edinburgh and Cambridge and Bath and plenty more. And then in the United States, there was New York and Oregon and San Francisco and Colorado and plenty more. Sorry for all the people I haven't mentioned specifically. And then around the world, New Zealand, China, Spain, Finland, Canada, wherever that is, we were able to build the equivalent of a level 4 Menger sponge, admittedly distributed around the planet. This was a project called MegaMenger. I will admit, one of the more ridiculous ideas I have ever come up with, and I can't believe it actually happened. I'm hugely in debt to Katie Steckles and Laura Tullman, who helped me put this whole thing together, and then Queen Mary University of London made it possible to provide the business cards to so many places all around the planet, and we actually did it. If you want to see more of the photos, you can go to megamenger.com, and we still have all the instructions on there. You can build your own one of these. You can even still send it in. We've got enough for a level 4, but we're still taking more photos as people build them all around the world. Check out the website. There are worksheets, resources, banners. There's the full set of printing instructions you can just give to a printer and they will make the cards up for you, or you can provide your own cards. At the very least, at the end of this video, go print out at home and make for yourself a level 1 Menger sponge. So that's MegaMenger, and that's why the Menger sponge has a very special place in my mathematical heart. But how does pi tie into this? Well, just when I thought I was able to leave the Menger sponge behind, I was over at a recreational math conference in Atlanta, USA. It's called the Gathering for Gardner. And actually, it was at the same meeting 2 years ago where I first met Laura and we hatched the ridiculous plan to do the whole MegaMenger project. And at the meeting this time, I did a presentation about my various videos where I've used pies to try and calculate the value of pi. I know it's hilarious. I did the one where I took hundreds of pies and put them in a circle. You can see that over on the Numberphile channel. And I talked about the video on this Stand Up Math channel a little while ago where I suspended a pie from a string and used a pi-endulum to calculate pi. Well, after my talk was finished and I went back to my seat to listen to the next talk, someone walked over to me, tapped me on the shoulder, and handed me a piece of paper. And then they just walked away and I unfolded it and I had a look and it said, squeezing pi from the Menger sponge. I was like, wow, I've never come across pi and the Menger sponge before. What on earth could this possibly be? And I managed to resist the temptation to Google it there and then because other people were doing their talks. Later on, I looked it up and I could not believe what I found. Once again, we need to start with another square. So here I am in once again a boring 2D square. So when I Googled squeezing pi from the Menger sponge, initially it gave me a slightly different variation on a Sapinski carpet. I went to a website where a guy called Ed Pegg had written a whole lot of Mathematica code to generate a Sapinski carpet, but then he made one slight tweak. So initially, if we take the area of this Sapinski carpet to be 4, so before we've done anything, we've punched nothing out, it's 4, we can now remove the center third like before. Now, we're not going to remove the center third of all the remaining squares. We're going to remove the center fifth. So actually, we're taking away 1/25th, or rather we're leaving 24/25ths. And so the area of this shape is 4 × 8/9 × 24/25ths. And now we can continue. All the remaining ones, we're going to take out the center seventh. So we're going to leave behind 48, 49th. And we can carry on all the way down. Next we'll have 63, 64th, and then 80, 81th, or whatever you want to call them. And this time, that is not tending to zero. This fractal has got some leftover surface area. And if you actually work out what it is, it's pi. Yep, you are looking at exactly pi surface area. As much as that sudden appearance of pi shocked me, classic pi, after a little while it made a smidgen of sense. Fractals and pi are quite well made for each other. To get a fractal, you have to do something over and over and over and over, and it only truly works if you do it infinitely many times. And in a recent video, which I will link to below, I tried to calculate pi using an infinite series. And again, you have to do the same thing over and over and over infinitely many times. And so this particular fractal is actually based on something called the Wallis formula, or the Wallis infinite product. If you multiply all these crazy fractions together, you get pi. And this shape in front of me is basically just doing that, but in a geometric way. And so this is called the Wallis sieve. But it still blows my mind that this thing, a square with a radius of one, so the distance from the center to hit the side at an orthogonal angle, has an area of pi. And you go, well, hang on, what is the other shape with a radius of one that has a surface area of pi? That's right, it's a circle. So this crazy shape here has the same surface area as a standard issue garden variety unit circle. But what about 3D? I mean, this worked in 2D. Surely we can generalize it up a dimension. Well, Ed wasn't sure. And these things are never guaranteed to work in higher dimensions. But instead of doing the elaborate working out first, he thought he'd just give it a go. So if you take a 3D cube and then you punch out the center 1/3 squares, and on the remaining squares, you punch out the center 1/5 squares, and then 1/7 and all the way down, the volume of the shape you end up with is indeed based on pi. He couldn't believe it when it came out to be 4/3 of pi. It is the volume of a sphere that would fit inside the cube. And that just blows my mind. The volume of that is the same as the volume of that. Maths, eh? So there you are, that is how you squeeze pi out of the MegaMenger. It may have been my all-time favorite fractal, but I didn't know it could do that until just a week ago. If you'd like to learn more about how to make your own origami one of these, you can watch the video which the MIT guys made about their part in the MegaMenger project. They've got a pretty good explanation of how you put it together, and there's a guest appearance from Janine Mosley herself. Underneath the video in the description, I will have a link both to the MegaMenger project and to Ed Pegg's page if you want to have a closer look at how to actually grab a hold and squeeze out some pie.